Dit is Herman Asterik en welkom van Jeddah in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia at HIMS ME, HIMS Middle East. We're going to discuss the top 10 benefits of integrating the healthcare enterprise, or IHC. The next benefit will be to address display. Why would you want to address display? Well, the DICOM and H.27 standard and most other communication standards only concern themselves with the information that is exchanged between two devices. There's nothing in the DICOM or H.27 standard that says how should the images be presented. For example, let's say you send digital mammography images to a workstation. The DICOM standard says exactly how to encode the digital mammography, what should be in the DICOM header. It tells exactly the protocol to use. So after the acknowledgement comes, or the successful store, status goes back from the workstation to the sender. The images are received, but there's no guarantee that they are displayed in the way that is normally done for this mammography, which is, as you look in the illustration, taking one image from one view and then the other image, for example, the left versus the right. Take the left and you mirror that and display it with the chest wand against each other. So that's a very specific what we call hanging protocol for digital mammography. So just saying that you support the DICOM standard does not guarantee that you will display the images in that way. However, if you say that you support the IHC profile for viewing digital mammography, then you can expect the images being displayed exactly as shown in this slide and exactly as the radiologist wants them to be displayed. If you now have computer-aided diagnosis or CAD marks, you also want them obviously displayed correctly. And that's also defined by IHC in another profile called evidence documents. And then especially I want to highlight that there's a new breast tomosynthesis profile out. A relatively new modality is the tomosynthesis. Breast tomosynthesis device where which we do not only have two views, but multiple views, or actually multiple acquisitions, for example 25 steps. And then the result will be a series of slices that also need to be displayed in a certain way, and that is all addressed in the breast tomosynthesis profile. Also, not only talking about the display for digital mammography, but also for many other devices, such as nuclear medicine, cardiac nuclear medicine, where we have a very specific way when we want to present the images. And again, if workstation just say, I support nuclear medicine, that would not necessarily mean that they can display them correctly on the workstation for a radiologist to look for. The next benefit will be CDs. Well, also a potentially major source of problems, because if anybody that has been involved with PACS systems know that when you get a CD from another hospital, there's always a chance that you might not be able to read the images from that CD for various reasons. The images might not be encoded in DICOM, there might not be a directory on there, they might not be encoded according to ISO standards that are defined in the standard. So the CD, or what we call a PDI, Portable Data for Imaging Profile, for IHC, reinforces the information in the DICOM standard that says how to encode these images on the CD. So I would definitely never purchase any CD burner or workstation that does not support the PDI profile. So that's not really a new or an additional information in the IHC standard, but it's basically just to reinforce what the standard already says. Another related profile is the IRC, Import Reconciliation Profile, and that allows images that are imported to be reconciled with images or information about the patient that is either already available in the information system or will be created in the information system. Why do we need this reconciliation? Well, there might be an accession number that is in the header of the images on the CD that is already used in the existing PACS system. It could be that a patient was already present in the information system of the hospital under a different ID, maybe a different name. So to reconcile that, we can import images from CD, then modify the DICOM header with the new information that makes these images consistent and allows them to be managed within the information system and the PACS of the new hospital. But then in addition, it has a very well-defined location where the old information that was initially on the CD can be maintained and retrieved if needed. The next benefit for IHC is to provide a shared resource platform, and that's the ITI, the IT infrastructure platform. This slide has a lot of information, talks about a lot of different things. Just talking about this slide probably be taking a two-day class. But I just want to highlight a couple of things from the ITI profiles. And basically, if you take the ITI profiles, and you can divide them up in six different groups. The first one will be patient identity management, to manage patients across different enterprises in a way that they are unique. And then we have the PICS, PDQ, and XCPD profiles, and of course the PAM, the profile as well. And basically what that does is allows information about patients to be queried, PDQ, and exchanged by PICS, and also in a point-to-point manner. So patient identity management is a shared resource. What I mean by that is that not only the radiology domain profiles can use it, but also the cardiology domain, the patient care domain, and the many different domains all can use this shared services. Second group will be the information exchange management to exchange documents, which is the XDS and exchange images, XDSI, and so on. That also can be done. We can share documents, for example, between lab systems. We can share documents between radiology systems. We can share between cardiology systems. All these different domains might have a need to share documents, and that can be done with the information exchange management. And then, of course, we want to do that in a secure manner. So security and privacy management with CT, consistent time, and AETNA being the node authorization and the audit trails. So if, for example, a lab result is being retrieved by a physician, that transaction needs to be audited, and we want to maintain that in an audit trail. And we want to do it exactly the same way as a radiologist would pull down an image at his home, for example, from the PACS system. We don't want to have different solutions for all these different domains for exactly the same function. Then there will be the provider and personnel management. If you want to exchange about certain providers, it would be good to have kind of a yellow pages that we know exactly about which Dr. John Smith we are talking about, because there are probably thousands of John Smith's physicians in the United States. Then workflow management, when we exchange information and we want to tell a little bit about the workflow, we want to exchange that. And then the last but not least, content management, that has to do with the CDA clinical document architecture, a standard way to exchange documents in a very well-defined template between these different systems. Another major benefit would be to provide enterprise and regional exchange. Even although I just mentioned the shared platform XDS and XDSI in the previous slide, I want to highlight as a separate feature because it is essential that we can exchange information between different providers. And to do that, we need to register the information we have, and we need to be able to exchange that across different enterprises. And then again, to do that in a standard way, we're using XDS, XDSI, so major benefit of the IHE specifications. And as you look at this transaction diagram, you get a little bit of an idea how this IHE specification looks. In this case, we see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different actors, and each actor has very well-defined transactions. So let's take in the bottom left corner, the document source, for example. A document source might be, for example, a PACS system that creates a diagnostic report, or a radiology information system that creates, or a voice recognition system provides a document. And the availability of the document can be registered with a document repository. And the transaction is called Provide and Register Document Set B, ITI 41. What does that mean? You can go to the ITI, part of the IHE specification. Remember, the ITI was the common infrastructure. And you look at transaction number 41, and you see exactly what HL7 transaction is used to that, and what is in that HL7 options and requirements. For my document repository, I can go to my document registry, which could be a health information exchange, using register document set transaction ITI 42. And then on the right side of the slide, the document consumer, for example, a physician, could talk with the document registry doing a query, again defined in ITI 18, which is a HL7 query message, and then know where the information is and pull them over using the retrieved document set. And in addition, we have a patient identity source on the top of the slide that feeds information to reconcile if there are different identifiers used, for example, between different entities. So this gives you kind of an idea how the IHE kind of works. Transactions between different actors that are exactly defined in the specification. And last but not least, I'd like to talk a little bit about what I have 10th benefit is how to exchange information about images. And there are two profiles that are important. Let's say there's a physician, a surgeon in the operating room, and the surgeon wants to get information about this patient. And the information was revealed in a CT scan that had 3,000 images, all the way from top to toe, from this patient that went for the CT scanner. However, the surgeon might be just looking for the gallbladder, for example, that's CT slice 387, 88 and 89. But instead of having to flip for all these images on his workstation in the OR, the radiologist could have identified what are the key or most important images. And then we call that a key image note. So anytime we want to exchange information about images, you can use what we call a structured report. This has a reference to important or critical images where we want to talk about. Another good example of similar profile would be IOCM, Information Object Change Management. This is critical anytime we have multiple copies of images. For example, there is a PAC system, and the PAC system sends a copy to the vendor neutral archive, and the vendor neutral archive might send maybe another copy to an enterprise system. Imagine that the PAC administrator finds out in the local hospital that there's a major problem with an image. The left-right indicator was wrong, or was misidentified, or for whatever reason. He wants to delete that image or replace it. And that information can then be also encoded in the form of a, what we call a key object note. So similar to the key image, we can say delete these images. So be able to exchange this information between these devices prevents the PACS administrator to have to go run down and find out exactly where was this copy of the image, where do I need to delete it, and so on. Because that's all automatically communicated between those different devices. So a very important profile as well. So these were the top 10 in my list, benefits of IHC. I could probably come up with 20 or 30 or maybe even more. But this, I think, gives really the gist of IHC, why is it so important. And that allows using IHC to improve the efficiency and the cost. Talk a little bit about efficiency. It's my belief that if we would implement IHC over all the different institutions, there's no question that we could be much more efficient. When I talk with my peers and other people in the industry, we all agree that workflow is the number one issue. And why is it an issue? Because in many cases, they don't use the capabilities of the PAC system, of the RIS system. They don't fully utilize all of the features that are provided as part of the IHC workflow definitions. So that's the second item. Workflow we can dramatically improve if we use the IHC profiles. And then, of course, interoperability. We need it to make sure that we proliferate and implement the electronic health records. We want to exchange the information between different entities. And last but not least, definitely simplification of the RFP requirements. It's much easier if I want to purchase something or intend to purchase something to say, listen, I want this device to meet these profiles from IHC, instead of having to go through the shopping list of all the different DICOM services, the different HL7 services, and for DICOM, these attributes in the worklist and these attributes in the images, and for the HL7, these trigger elements and these components and in the messages, it's much easier. So in conclusion, if you want to have more information about these profiles, there's quite a resource library available at the IHC website, which is IHC.net. In addition, of course, if you want to learn about this, there are books, there's also training available. OTEC provides a whole set of training classes on DICOM 8.7, IHC, PAC systems, EMR. So thank you for your attention. Any questions, do not hesitate to contact us. Enjoy.